Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Return of Sherlock Holmes, Further Extraordinary Tales of the Famous Sleuth, edited by Maxim Jakubowski, narrated by Roger Clark. Introduction. The initial volume of brand new Sherlock Holmes stories in our series of anthologies for Mango Media attracted such tremendous interest from talented contemporary writers all over that we received a score of wonderful stories we were unable to include in the Book of Extraordinary New Sherlock Holmes Stories. So a vote of gratitude is due to Chris and Brenda at Mango, who quickly agreed to a second volume and a fifth book in the series. In addition to the stories held over from our first round, it gave me an opportunity to solicit new material from a handful of authors new to the series, including writers from Spain and Portugal. Proof, if ever there was, that the life and times of the sage of Baker Street and his familiar cohorts and adversaries are of universal appeal. And how could I say no to return appearances from some of our esteemed regulars, for whom any theme in the crime, thriller, and mystery genre represents a worthy challenge. So, freely dip into these stories as the game is yet again afoot, and investigations, puzzles, ratiocinations, and thrills are served up on a plate in a further 15 stories that bring the Sherlockian canon to life in all its Victorian splendor and excitement. Encounter fog-surrounded streets, the eternal battle of wits between the great detective and his new foes, and yet more dastardly crimes which our hero is compelled to solve, even when it repeatedly pits him and his faithful sidekick, Dr. Watson, against forces of darkness and evil. Better critics and academics than me have tried to explain why the adventures of Sherlock Holmes have proven so popular for well over a century and speak to every new successive generation of readers in every single country of the world, ranging across race, language, and age, and why the subtle art of detection proves such a wonderful draw for the imagination. But it's elementary, dear reader. And the answer is their charm, their sharply unforgettable characters, and perfectly engineered clockwork-like plots and dollops of acutely drawn atmosphere. So welcome back to the unique and wonderful world of London's most famous consultant detective. You will not be disappointed. The Silver Lining by Bonnie McBird. There was a satisfying snap as I popped open the crown of my new silk opera hat. I had purchased it the day before at Lock & Co. on St. James, an extravagance to be sure, but if I had to accompany my friend Sherlock Holmes to the opera, I might as well find some amusement in the doing. It had been a long evening of Verdi, at least for me, but seemed to raise my companion's spirits, which had been ragged of late. And for that silver lining in the voluminous clouds of music that had inundated us, I was grateful. Afterward, as we joined the crowd descending the grand staircase at the opera, my ears were ringing from the overdose. A strident female voice from behind us suddenly cut through the murmur. "Mr. Sherlock Holmes, is that you?" The accent was clipped, patrician. I turned back to see a dark-haired, beautiful woman in her late 30s cutting through from above, gesturing with her decorative fan. She exuded privilege, from her costly beaded dress and elaborate coiffure to the manner with which she parted the hoi polloi, or so she seemed to regard them, to reach us. With her was a very handsome and much younger man. In a moment she stood on our stair, blocking all behind us. "I am the Countess Rameau," announced the lady. "Call me Eleanor, and I need you to solve my little problem." Her eyes flicked over to me once, then again, and lingered just a moment too long. A man directly behind me on the stairs harumphed impatiently. "Madam," said Holmes with a smile, I came to enjoy Verdi. I conduct business on Baker Street. He pulled a card from his jacket, handed it to me over his shoulder, and without a further word continued down the stairs. The lady looked after him in dismay. "Sincerest apologies," I said, with a little bow, presenting her the card. "Here is the address." Her young man snatched it from my hand. She took the card from her gentleman, and her eyes met mine. She glanced over me a third time, and appeared pleased at what she saw. "And you are?"
"Dr. John Watson, Mr. Holmes's colleague."
She smiled warmly.
"Sir, I will come to see you, then."
As they departed, her young man flashed me an angry look.
She was true to her word. At 10 the next morning, Mrs. Hudson announced a visitor. "To see you, Doctor, a very fine lady, the Countess Rameau."
A moment later, the magnificent Countess stood before us, intent on some mission, and with a large silk reticule at her side. Her luminously pale, beautiful face and sharp hazel eyes were dramatically set off by a bright hyacinth silk dress, embroidered in silver and white. Our modest flat seemed dingy with this elegant flower in its midst. I rose to greet her, but Holmes remained seated, busily attending to his pipe.
"Dr. Watson and the rude Mr. Holmes, I have come on urgent business," said Countess Rameau.
"Please be seated, madam," I said, gesturing to a chair near the window. "May I offer you a tea or coffee?"
"Put that infernal pipe away," she commanded Holmes. "I abhor tobacco."
She sat. He looked over at her in amusement and paused mid-light.
"And yet your husband's fortunes depend on several tobacco plantations in, I believe, Virginia," he drawled.
He nevertheless set the pipe down. He had looked her up, no doubt.
"That is of no matter. I have come for help, not what passes for wit in this dreary place."
"Of course, madam," said I. "Please tell us your problem."
"Silver. Silver is my problem. I have a great deal of very special, unusual, unique, rare silver. The set is a family heirloom. It is Baroque, original, of great beauty."
"A great many adjectives," remarked Holmes. "Stolen, I suppose?"
"Yes, from our home in Belgravia."
"All of it?"
"No, select pieces only." "Belgravia, you say? But you and the Count reside in Bedfordshire, do you not? Flintwood Hall? A grand place, they say, Watson."
"Our London pied-à-terre is situated in Belgravia." That area of London was an enclave of the very wealthy. I wondered at the size of this pied-à-terre.
"When did this silver go missing?" Holmes asked.
"Recently."
"When exactly did someone break in? Were locks or windows forced? Any witnesses?"
"Specifics, madam, if you would like me to help you," Holmes said.
"No. No, nothing like that. No break-ins. The butler noticed it last week. He and I believe it to be someone in the household. In fact, I am sure of it."
"Last week? What did the police have to say?"
"I have not notified the police."
"Why not?"
"Because, well, I know the thief."
She paused, and Holmes waved her to continue, as though encouraging a child.
"It is, I am sure, Clara," said she, "a new lady's maid hired to look after our female guests."
"You are certain of this? How?"
"A woman knows."
She glanced over at me with undisguised coquetry.
"Madam, that is insufficient."
"Why do you suspect this maid particularly?" said Holmes.
"Several costly items have appeared in her room, new dresses and so forth. Gifts rather than purchases, perhaps. That is what we call circumstantial evidence. It will not hold in a court of law. What has Miss Clara to say of the matter?"
"We have not spoken of it."
Astounding, I thought. "Mr. Holmes might discreetly question this young lady," I suggested. She beamed at me.
"A lovely idea, Doctor."
Then her face took on a childish pout. but you cannot question her. She is with my husband at Flintwood.
Ah, said Holmes. There was a pause. The lady exhaled softly and smoothed her skirts. With a little toss of her head, she continued,
I don't care about that. It'll be over by Christmas. That is our pattern.
She turned to me with a warm smile.
My husband spends the autumn in the countryside at Flintwood hunting and so on. I spend the season here for the opera and ballet and to make new friends, Doctor.
Her gaze lingered on me, and she smiled. Beyond her, I could see one of Holmes's eyebrows lift in amusement.
She turned back to him, and he was all innocence. How can I help you, Countess? He said. First, Mr. Holmes, find this silver, wherever it is, and buy it back for me. Here are photographs of the missing pieces and money to purchase them.
She removed a small brown envelope from her reticule, followed by a small suede pouch, and handed them both to me. I looked inside the pouch to see a wealth of gold sovereigns. I handed both to Holmes.
Mr. Holmes, find out who sold my silver. Prove that I am right.
Holmes eyed the photographs.
These are unique pieces. Quite beautiful.
He handed them to me. They were serving pieces, ornate but odd, with boar's heads, foxes, and elven faces woven into the curling, leafy designs. Holmes emptied the pouch onto the table next to him. The gold sovereigns gleamed in the morning sunlight streaming in off Baker Street. He frowned.
I fear this sum will be insufficient for both the silver and the information. Good, I see you know the value.
She took out a second pouch and dangled it in the air. Once again I stood up and ferried the thing to Holmes. It was a peculiar dance we were doing in this meeting.
A description of the maid, if you please. Clara is short, dark hair, slender, pretty. Oh, and she has a large mole on her right cheek.
Holmes stood.
Your delay in this matter is unfortunate, but if we are in luck, and the silver is still in London after a whole week, I shall have it back for you by the morning. Good day, Countess.
The lady rose with a smile.
You may keep all the money that you do not use in the purchase, said she. Oh, one other thing. There is an auction of fine silver midday at Sotheby, Williams and Hodge. I plan to attend, but I will need someone to accompany me. My usual friend is unavailable. Dr. Watson, might you join me?
Normally I would be inclined to meet such a request, but the plan made me uncomfortable for reasons I could not articulate.
Your silver will not be there, madam, if that is what you are thinking, said Holmes. That august organization does not operate as a venue for thieves. They are quite careful about provenance. Oh, I know, said she. I go for enjoyment. I do love beautiful things. I may pick up something that takes my fancy, Dr. Watson.
I'm afraid I must...
Watson, I see no harm. I will not need you for this simple matter, said Holmes.
My back to the lady, I glowered at him. He smiled innocently. 2 hours later, I sat next to the Countess in the large, airy auction room of Sotheby, Wilkinson and Hodge on Wellington Street, just off the Strand. The room buzzed with anticipation. Surrounding us were a swarm of wealthy bidders, colourfully attired in the latest fashions, coiffed, perfumed, polished. In addition, there were a number of scholarly types, scanning the catalogue, reference books, and lists in hand. There was nothing quite so eager, I thought, as a collector in search of a mismarked treasure, unless it was a very wealthy individual in search of a bargain. I was seated on the aisle of a row of folding wooden chairs, the Countess beside me. Disconcertingly, her arm had remained looped through mine. We were receiving several amused glances. She had become a tittering schoolgirl, pointing out this and that well-dressed bidder and whispering gossip into my ear, all the while clinging to me as though we were two young lovers who had temporarily escaped from our chaperone.
Again and again her bidding paddle flew up and down as she gleefully bid on several frivolous items. One, two of them, and had me collect them for her, rather than arranging for later delivery. At one point I stood to let someone into our row, and just as they passed, she playfully tapped me on the buttocks with that same paddle, giggling. "Madam," I said. I heard a tisk from the row behind us and sat down. I could feel myself flushing with embarrassment. But it was as if I had thrown kerosene onto the flame. She leaned in and kissed my cheek. "You are adorable." She then turned to the people behind her and said, "Handsome, isn't he? Don't you wish you were me?" A tight-laced woman directly behind us snorted in derision. But an elegant older man with a monocle and glittering smile leaned in. "Countess Rameau, I have always wished to be with you," he said with the tip of his hat. "Take your place in the queue, Baron," said another younger man, glistening in pomade and with a flower in his buttonhole. He winked at the Countess. It was with utter relief that I later deposited Eleanor, as she asked to be called, at her home in Belgravia, declined her invitation to linger over a sherry, and retreated to the safety of 221B. No man dislikes being called handsome, yet I had felt less cherished than on display. A glass of good whiskey and a smoke set me quickly aright, and I was in decent enough cheer when Holmes returned at 7, carrying a large, heavy carpet bag. He looked tired, but I read success on his keen features. "The silver?" I asked. "It took some doing, but yes, I have all of it in hand, and a partial description of the seller, hooded and attempting to conceal herself, but female, small, pale, with dark hair, and, I am sorry to say, a large beauty mark on her right cheek." "The silly young thing was foolish enough to try to sell the goods herself," I said. "And yet she must have lugged that amount of silver with some difficulty," said Holmes, thoughtfully. He dashed off a note to the Countess and sent it to Belgravia with our page, Billy. As I poured him a celebratory whiskey, I noticed some newspapers and periodicals open on the table. I caught a glimpse of an article titled "The Rambunctious Rameaus" in some scandal rag. I looked up to see Holmes, staring at me with unusual interest. "Survived the afternoon intact, I see," he asked, with a smile.
"Really, Holmes, you knew what she was like, didn't you?"
"Watson, all of London does. The Countess and her husband are in a famously permissive marriage. They regularly take lovers, throw discretion to the winds, and are seen everywhere about town with them. I've been doing a little research. You are, apparently, Madam's type."
"Oh, for God's sake!"
"You are a brave man, Watson."
"Ha! That must be my attraction," I said. "That and my biceps, apparently."
There was a pause before we both burst out laughing.
We were in Belgravia at 9 the next morning, but to Holmes's surprise, the butler informed us that the Countess had left for her country estate the previous evening. A note addressed to me directed us to meet her at Flintwood with the silver, as she had decided to confront Clara after all. Outside, on the pavement before Eaton Square Gardens, Holmes and I decided we would take the train to Pebbleworth, the nearest station to their country seat.
"But later this afternoon, Watson, I have a few inquiries to make before we travel to the lair of the philandering Rameaus. I will be happy to wash my hands of this business."
"Perhaps you should go on alone," I suggested.
"I wouldn't think of it, my dear Watson," said he. "Besides, I would like a witness when I disclose the sizable payment I have managed to retain from the initial two batches of sovereigns."
At the end of the afternoon, after an hour's train ride and another hour in a hired carriage to the estate, we stood on the steps of a grand three-story stone and marble edifice at the end of a long driveway lined with poplars.
The trees whipped about in the wind that had come up, and dark grey clouds had made their appearance on the horizon. I shivered, having only a light coat with me. A foolish error for an Englishman in this unpredictable season, but it had been mild and sunny when we left London. I hoped we would not be long in this place. We were not expected. Holmes's name meant nothing to the sour-faced butler, and to our surprise, the Countess was not at home here either. The man, Peterson, by name, advised us to take lodging in the nearby town. "Madam may arrive some time in the next few days. You might try back then." Peterson then refused to provide a carriage, and despite the incipient storm, directed us to walk to the main road a mile away and try our luck with some passing vehicle. This was surprisingly inhospitable, I thought. Holmes indicated the large carpet bag he had placed at his feet. "We have something to deliver to the lady, and I don't wish to have it hanging about at an inn. It is precious silver from the Count and Countess's home in Belgravia." Just as he said this, a tall, elegant man appeared behind the butler. "Pearson," he said sharply, "what is this about our silver?" Minutes later, Holmes, having introduced us and stated our business, we faced Count Rameau across an enormous low table in a salon lined with gigantic oil paintings. Through the French windows behind him, a formal row of rose bushes shuddered in the brisk wind. The Count reclined, and, as we spoke, continuously smoothed luxurious wings of black hair away from his face. He seemed as vain as any theatre actor, but his eyes kept darting to me. Odd, I thought. Holmes related the Countess's story, leaving out her suspicions about the specific maid. He opened the carpet bag to reveal the treasure within. The Count glanced down at it and waved a hand. "Yes, that is ours. Hers, really," as she said. He looked Holmes over. "You have come a very long way to deliver it, so I presume you are here for payment?" He rang for the butler, who appeared in an instant. "Peterson, take this silver, list the contents, lock it in the pantry." The fellow departed. The Count turned back to Holmes. "All right, you've done your little job. Now, what do we owe you for your service?" "My fee has already been paid. Don't you wish to know how the silver came to be missing, Count?" asked Holmes. The Count shrugged. He then leaned back in his chair and once more languidly appraised me without any attempt to hide it. I felt distinctly uncomfortable under the man's gaze. "Who are you again?" he suddenly demanded of me. His gaze flicked between Holmes and me, and he smiled. "Friend and colleague, what does that mean?" "Exactly." "It means precisely what it says, Count Rameau. Dr. Watson assists me in my investigations. Do you have a young lady on your staff? A lady's maid named Clara?" Holmes said. The man ignored the question. He continued to stare at me. "Doctor, eh? Have you met my wife on the occasion of her hiring your friend and colleague? If not, I feel certain the Countess would enjoy meeting you. Eleanor is due to arrive tomorrow." The Count turned back to Holmes. "This could be amusing," said he. "I am of a mind to invite you to stay." "No, really, I don't think," I began. "Thank you, we will accept," said Holmes. "May I interview your maid, Clara?"
"Why?"
Holmes said nothing. The inference was clear.
"Oh, I see. My wife is trying to pin the theft on the little Robin Redbreast, is she? Well, I doubt Clara did it."
He smiled and rang. The butler appeared, and he sent for the maid. I puzzled over the Robin Redbreast comment. In a moment, the girl appeared, bobbing her head in respect and lingering in the doorway until the Count bade her enter. She was slender, pale, dark-haired, perhaps 17 or 18, with a large beauty mark on her right cheek. Her starched maid's costume was unusual in that it featured no typical high-ruffled collar, but instead a plunging décolleté. It was as though she were costumed as a French maid in a West End farce. I glanced at Holmes, who was taking all this in, and probably a great deal more. The girl stood before us. As she did so, the Count moved to her side and put his hand on her shoulder. It was less a gesture of protection than it was of ownership. I did not like it. She seemed to shrink, but the Count gave her a sharp look. In response, she straightened up and met our eyes with a forced but steady gaze. "Clara," said the Count, "this gentleman wishes to question you. Please answer him as best you can." His hand remained on her shoulder. Clearly the man cared nothing for propriety, but this seemed to be a family trait. He patted her shoulder, and the pat turned into a caress. The girl held steady, as though nothing odd were happening, but began to flush. Not just her face, but her neck and chest as well went red as well. Robin Redbreast, he had called her. I found myself hot with embarrassment. I glanced at Holmes. He gave little indication, but I sensed that even he was uncomfortable at this bizarre display. "Gentlemen," said the Count, "she's all yours. Ask her what you will. Clara, answer Mr. Hearn's. Holmes, I prefer to interview her privately." "No," said the Count. There was a pause. The Count's hand remained on Clara's shoulder. I could have been mistaken, but I thought I saw it tighten. My stomach lurched. "All right, then. What is your family name, if you would, Miss?" asked Holmes, gently. "Smith. Miss Smith. How long have you been in the employ of the Count and Countess?"
"4 months next week, sir."
"And who hired you, Miss?"
"Sir did."
She glanced sideways at her employer, then looked down. His hand caressed her shoulder. The girl kept her reactions well masked, yet I thought I noted fear in her eyes. Holmes observed her closely.
"Count," he asked, "are you in the habit of hiring ladies' maids who work for you? Is this not usually the purview of the housekeeper, or indeed the lady of the house?"
"I choose them when it suits me to do so, but that is hardly any of your business, Mr. Holmes. Are you finished with your questions?"
"No." "Clara, do you normally have access to the silver in the Rameau household in Belgravia?"
For the first moment, the girl looked blank.
"The silver?"
she said.
"No. Why?" "Some went missing, and the Countess seems convinced that you took it."
Holmes shrugged, as though that were the silliest notion, but he was obliged to say it. She did not reply, but looked confused, and glanced up at her employer. He shook his head.
"I don't know any silver," said she, "and I have no reason to touch it. I am a lady's maid. Butler locks it up, I think,"
said the girl, suddenly uneasy.
"Then you do know of it?"
"Only as I have seen it on the table, sir."
"So you see, Clara is no thief," said the Count. "We are finished here. Leave us, Clara." At the command, the girl started, then fairly dashed from the room as he rang for the butler. "I've changed my mind. I ask that you leave Flintwood now," said the Count. There was the sound of thunder, and over our host's shoulder I could see that a downpour now pummeled the garden. Peterson appeared at the doorway.
"Peterson, pay Mr. what was it, Holmes, for his trouble, £10. Then send these two off to Pebbleworth Station in our carriage," said the Count. "You have got what you came for, Mr. Holmes. Good day."
"Sir," said the butler,
"the carriage is away, fetching provisions for the Countess's arrival tomorrow, and our landau is in town, with the wheels in repair. All we have available just now is the dog cart, or the 2 field ponies. Your hunters are at the farrier's."
The Count relented.
"All right, I suppose you must spend the night. Peterson, have James take them to—"
"The blue room is available, sir," said Peterson. The Count nodded sharply. "Perfect.
The blue room, as it turned out, was a dismal little space tucked away under the eaves in the chilly north end of the house, with blue wallpaper peeling from the walls and the wind rattling through cracks in the window. Two hard single beds, a lone armoire, and a washstand with two threadbare towels were the only amenities. A single half-burned tallow candle sat on a rickety table between the two beds. We had passed numerous guest rooms, their doors open to reveal sumptuous furnishings. All of these, of course, had stood empty. "Holmes," I said.
"One night only, Watson."
I did not plan for an overnight stay.
Nor did I. But we have little choice. Unless you would care to walk back to Pebbleware through this,
he waved to the window. An icy rain beat down on the verdant landscape, now growing grey under the settling dusk. The small fireplace was cold and empty, nothing to burn. In an hour, two dried sandwiches and two bruised apples arrived at the room, along with a carafe of cloudy water and a pot of lukewarm tea. I have dined better in a pauper's house. And so at we began a restless and chilly night, sleeping in our clothes on the hard beds, with one thin blanket each. It was after 3 a.m. when I was awakened by Holmes shaking me by the shoulder. He held the candle, guttering in the cold, draughty room. He was drenched, and cold droplets from his sleeve hit me on the neck.
"Watson, come. There is evil afoot. We have work to do. I will explain later."
I leapt from the bed and threw on my thin coat. We ran out into the rainy night like two thieves, my blood rising to the challenge of the chase. Crossing a wide yard, our footsteps crunching on the gravel, we proceeded downhill over a soaked lawn, then down a brick path to the stables. The downpour had dwindled to a cold, spitting rain, and a watery moon glowed faintly silver through the clouds. Now I, too, was soaked. The stables were black, and, as we approached, I heard a horse nickering softly at our presence, then another in answer. We continued around to the back, to an elaborate construction previously hidden from view. Once out of sight of the main house, Holmes carefully lit a dark lantern he had procured somewhere on the estate. The structure appeared to be a new addition. One large room, with pipes for indoor plumbing at one end and a single window. From it, a warm light burned through closed pink curtains. We moved toward it, and I could see through a sliver of an opening a young woman in her night clothes, sitting on an enormous bed with velvet coverlets and many pillows. Clara. She was alone in what was clearly a hideaway. Unlike the other servants, who were usually housed under the eaves in the main house as we were, Clara had been isolated here. In spite of the hour, the girl was awake, sitting on the edge of her bed, rocking and nodding, whether with joy or to comfort herself, I could not tell. I moved closer to the window, but Holmes's thin fingers grasped my arm and pulled me back.
"Watch where you step, the footprints."
He pointed to the mud below the window, under the eaves, and thus protected a little from the rain.
"What?
Whose?" I squinted.
"Looks like a woman's shoe." "Watson, I believe this girl is in danger. We must go in there and interview her apart from the Count." "But this is terribly improper, Holmes. The girl is alone, in her night clothes. Can't it wait till morning?" "That is why you are here. I need a witness. This girl's life may depend on it. The Count had her up in his room for over an hour this night."
"Why, this place here seems to be designed for..."
"Exactly. But while Clara was there, your friend, the Countess, arrived, and..."
"She is not my friend."
"Shh. It was then about 2. She entered the house, careful to make no sound. Clara was still with the Count. I expected some confrontation, but instead the Countess shortly exited the house, carrying an umbrella and a small sack. I followed her down to the stables here and watched as she peered through the window, entered Clara's empty room, lit a candle, and placed something in the back of the lowest drawer over there.
"She's trying to set up the girl with another theft," I exclaimed.
"You astound, Watson. She then left and returned to the main house. I meant to retrieve whatever it was she left, but don't step there," I said.
"Sorry, is this the Countess's footprint, do you think?"
"Of course. Keep your voice down. I meant to go in and fetch the item, but the girl returned before I could."
"But this has already been tried, and it failed," I pointed out. "The Count will no doubt defend the girl, as he did today with us. He doesn't care if she's a thief."
"Something has changed, Watson. The Countess has raised her game. It was she who sold the silver disguised as the girl, I would wager, though it will be difficult to prove. This couple has broken more than a few hearts. Their antics are games to them, but dire to some they have seduced."
"Do you really think the girl is in actual danger?"
"I do. Depending on what is in that drawer, the girl could hang for the theft."
"My God!" I cried, but just as I did, the pink curtains were yanked open, and the face of Clara Smith stared out at the window at us, only inches from our own. She screamed.
It seemed I had been asleep only minutes when Holmes shook me awake a second time. Shortly after a discussion with Clara in her hideaway, he'd insisted I return to our room while he attended to a few small matters.
"What time is it?" I asked.
Bright sunlight now flooded through the small window of our awful room. I blearily took in his utterly soaked clothing. "What have you been up to?"
"Later. Come, we are to join the Countess for breakfast in the orangery. Say nothing of our visit last night."
In the orangery, we found Countess Rameau seated at one end of a long table. On a sideboard were silver dishes of fruits, pastries, and sausages, along with a tureen of scrambled eggs. She looked up to smile warmly at me, then gasped when she noticed the state of my clothing. I was still quite damp, but Holmes was literally dripping.
"Oh, Doctor, you must be chilly. Come here. Sit by the fire near me. I take it you brought the recovered silver, Mr. Holmes, and identified the thief?" "The silver is here," said he. "And the seller had a mole on her cheek. We are very fortunate in this distinctive identification."
The Countess smiled and was about to reply when the Count burst into the room, all in a fury and near hysteria, Peterson anxiously trailing him. "Find it! Find it! Search everywhere! The servants' quarters, everywhere!" The Count seemed surprised to see us all there.
"Eleanor, when did you arrive?"
"In the night, darling."
When, exactly?"
"Maybe 5, 6 this morning. What is the matter, dear?"
"My inkwell. It has been stolen. Dear God, someone took the inkwell."
He keened in agony, nearly tearing out his hair.
"Oh, dear," said the Countess, arising and rushing to her husband. "Not the inkwell?"
The Count nodded and covered his face with his hands. She turned to us.
"A precious antique. The inkwell that was used by William Shakespeare. It sits on the Count's desk. He writes his daily list from it every morning. That remarkable item is the pinnacle of our family's collection."
Holmes and I exchanged a small glance. That old thing we discovered in Clara's drawer must have been this. The girl could indeed have hung for such a theft. I had sensed at the time that Holmes knew more, but had explained nothing to me. I had no idea what he had up his sleeve.
"Shakespeare's inkwell,"
said my friend with a smile. Now that would be a treasure, acquired by you, I understand.
Gone! Gone! It was there when I retired, shouted the Count.
Darling, I think I know who might have taken it, said the Countess. Mr. Holmes, will you please report what you have found about the missing silver?
The Count looked up from his despair to bark at her.
Peterson already has your damned silver. Yes, I know that he found it, Eleanor. That is nothing compared to this inkwell, nothing.
But, darling, our silver was sold in London, and Mr. Holmes can describe the person who did so. Perhaps the same thief stole both, Mr. Holmes?
I can indeed describe the seller of your silver, sir, said Holmes. The buyer identified her as a delicate, dark-haired lady.
That could be anyone, moaned the Count.
But with a distinctive mole on her right cheek, added my friend. The Count looked up in surprise.
I told you, darling, Clara. She is a thief, said the Countess.
If so, you may find the inkwell in her room, I would imagine, said Holmes.
I grew nervous at this, but had learned to keep faith with Holmes's odd plans.
Yes, of course, said the Countess. It must be there.
Everyone, follow me. Peterson, call the police, shouted the Count.
I noticed the hint of a secret smile from the Countess as her husband dashed off. In a minute, the four of us, followed shortly by Peterson and a footman, arrived in the secret room. It was empty. Stripped bare. Drawers open, armoire gaping, no clothes, nothing. The girl was gone, along with all her things. Even I was surprised at this. The Count and Countess stared at the empty room, united in their dismay. The Count sank down upon the bed, covering his face. The lady was first to recover.
We must search. Perhaps she left it behind.
Holmes had positioned himself in front of the small chest of three drawers. The top drawer lay on the floor empty. The second was wide open and also empty. The bottom drawer remained closed. The Countess edged toward it, mesmerized.
It is of no use, madam. The girl is gone, said Holmes,
as if he did not notice her strange attention to the one closed drawer he was blocking.
If she stole it, she would have taken it with her.
But we have not looked everywhere, cried the Countess. That drawer closed behind you.
The girl has gone, Eleanor. Gone with my treasure, moaned the Count.
She will head for London, no doubt, said Holmes.
But the Countess continued to stare at the chest of drawers.
But that drawer, the one closed behind you, step aside, Mr. Holmes. Step aside, I say, said she.
Holmes did not move.
Really, madam, do you think she would clean out the room entirely and leave this one drawer?
Step aside, she shouted.
Holmes was strangely calm.
Yes, madam, he moved off.
She ran to the drawer and yanked it open. It was empty, except for a small envelope of pink paper. She grabbed it, read what was printed upon it, and went white. She closed her eyes and staggered to the bed, sitting down upon it next to her husband. Then, as if realizing where she sat, she leapt up, horrified.
"Pull yourself together, Eleanor. What does that say?"
asked the Count. He stood and snatched the pink envelope from his wife's hands.
"Oh, just some advertisement." He dropped it on the floor. "Dear God, that girl absconded with my... How could she?"
His face suddenly lit up with the force of a brilliant idea.
"Mr. Holmes, you found the silver. Do you think I could implore you to find the inkwell as well? Do you think you could? Oh, please. I would pay anything to get it back. Name your price. Anything. She cannot have gone far. You could trace her, could you not, if you start at once?"
Holmes paused and eyed the tearful Count and Countess.
"I believe I could," said he. "But is it the inkwell, not the girl, that most interests you?
Would you pay £200 for its return?
I would pay you £500. More! Name your price.
Five it is, then. Please write your check now, and arrange for our ride to the station. Unless it has disappeared into thin air, I will be able to deliver the inkwell to you in short order. The Count and Countess swept from the room. Watson, bring that little pink envelope, if you would, said Holmes, with a quick smile.
I retrieved it from the floor and followed him, still in the dark as to his plans. Moments later, we stood in the Count's study as he tearfully wrote out a check to Holmes. My friend took it, folded it in half, and placed it in the one dry spot in his clothing, the inside pocket of his jacket.
Thank you, he smiled.
Peterson, the carriage. Mr. Holmes and Dr. Watson must be on the next train to London, said the Count. He looked up at Holmes. You feel certain she went there?
If I were to sell the authentic inkwell of William Shakespeare, that is where I would go. Within days, hours perhaps, it might be en route to the continent, or even to America.
You could trace such a thing?
I make it my business to track many aspects of criminal London, sir.
If it leaves the country, I would never see it again, cried the Count. Hurry, please. Peterson, the next train is in an hour. Gentlemen, you can just make it.
Holmes patted his pocket.
This fee is for the return of your item, correct?
Yes, I said so, and I must know the thief.
No matter when, no matter who.
Of course, but the sooner the better. I'll see her hang for this, cried the Count.
Holmes and I looked at each other. He turned back to the Count.
She could indeed hang for stealing an item of such apparent value. But of course, she is of no concern to you. What about you, madam?
What do you mean? Said the Count.
But Holmes stayed fixed on the lady.
I understand several of the Count's young friends, your lady's maids, have been through a similar adventure to Miss Clara Smith, a Miss Isabel Christie, and, oh yes, a Miss Caroline O'Hurley. Do you know what happens to a maid when she is dismissed without a reference? They are often condemned to living in destitution on the streets, as those two currently do.
What?
How do you know this? Said the Countess. What has this to do with my inkwell? Shouted the Count.
Holmes continued staring at the lady. She cleared her throat.
Henry, said she, accusation in her tone,
you were to provide references for them.
Her husband waved her off. I may have forgotten once or twice. That is not my concern. He turned to Holmes. But your spying on me is. How do you know about these girls? What is your game, sir? Said the Count, staring at Holmes in growing fury. Give me back my check.
I made it my business to understand your family's patterns, Count. You and your wife are well known in London. Many people follow your adventures avidly. Whole columns in the papers have been devoted to them, but I think you are aware. You cultivate notoriety because you can. Even your inkwell has been written up and pictured in the papers.
What? Are you attempting to blackmail me? It is of no use. I hide nothing.
Blackmail you? No.
Holmes held back a laugh.
Even if I were to stoop to such tactics, there is little I could reveal which would exceed your actual reputation.
The Count paused, took a deep breath, and composed himself. The Countess put her arm through her husband's, as if to present a united front.
But the inkwell, Henry, the inkwell, it is missing. The girl is gone. Clara stole the silver. She must have stolen that. Madam, you stole the silver, said Holmes. Will you confess, or need I go on?
Darling, you stole your own silver, said the Count.
No, of course not. Mr. Holmes has identified the seller. She had a mole. It was Clara. Madam, you force my hand. And since you have not made the inference, Count, the pink envelope, if you please, Watson, kindly read what it says.
I pulled it from my pocket. I read that inside are 12 fancy dress ball mouche or party patches.
What are those? And what does this have to do with anything? Asked the Count.
I was wondering the same.
These are false beauty marks, or moles, made of velvet, said my friend, in vogue in the last century and used today for fancy dress balls.
The Count looked confused.
I thought Clara's beauty mark was real. The duplicitous little wench!
Holmes laughed.
Clara's? No, hers was real. These false patches were in Madame's cosmetic case. She used one when she sold the silver.
But of course. The import of this gradually dawned. The Count turned to his wife.
You were the seller? You stole your own silver?
The Countess shrugged.
Oh, darling, I was justified. You crossed a line with Clara. You know you did, bringing her to your own room. But the girl is a thief, after all. She took your inkwell.
I certainly didn't.
Ah, madam, you persist beyond all logic, cried Holmes. All right. I saw you place the inkwell in the drawer last night, the drawer you so insisted on opening just now.
That was odd, said the Count.
Liar! You have no proof. Your word only.
The Countess stood firm, defiant.
Why would I deign to come to that room in the middle of the night? Why, indeed. And yet I watched you do so while the occupant was elsewhere.
Holmes reached into the carpet bag, which lay at his feet, and unwrapped a dainty green embroidered shoe, stained badly with mud.
This shoe matches a print under the stable house window. Yours, madam.
You have been inside my room? Cried the Countess.
Holmes laughed.
You already knew this, madam. Where else would I have retrieved the pink envelope?
I shall have you up on charges for trespassing, she snarled.
Interesting, said Holmes.
He turned to the Count.
You must have noticed your wife's great concern with the drawer. That is where I saw her place it.
Oh, Eleanor, why? Cried her husband. Why would you take the inkwell?
The Countess paused, but she was not finished.
Fire with fire. I know you, Henry. You fell in love with this one. I had to do something.
Exactly as Holmes had surmised.
But then, where is it now, Eleanor? Where is it now?
That little strumpet must have found it and taken it, because, oh, all right, I admit I left it there. But you cannot deny. The girl is gone, and so is the inkwell. Was the inkwell still there in the drawer when you placed the pink envelope in it, Mr. Holmes? Yes. When I opened the drawer, there it was. So you see, the girl is still a thief, cried the woman.
I shall never see it again, moaned the Count.
I dare say you will, said Holmes. It was in the drawer when I opened it, but not when I closed it.
He reached into his carpet bag, removed the inkwell, and set it on the table. It was a small brass item, struck from a mould, ornately carved, originally, but quite worn, and with a sizable dent. The Count snatched it to his bosom with a gasp, which turned into fury.
What? You trickster! Give me back my check. I'll have you arrested for theft and perjury. My wife is no thief. We are just playing a game. The courts will uphold this. Peterson, call the police.
I have done so some time ago, sir, said Peterson calmly.
I have produced your item and named the thief. Those are the terms. There are witnesses, said Holmes.
He gestured to me and to the butler. I nodded. To my surprise, so did the taciturn servant.
But you had it all along, cried the Count.
So did many others.
What? What do you mean?
You will recall that the London papers mentioned your great family treasure. It took me but 2 hours yesterday, while Madam enjoyed the company of Dr. Watson here at an auction, to learn what I needed. Let me clarify. Here, too, is your inkwell.
Holmes reached into his bag and placed a second, identical inkwell on the desk.
And here? He reached in again and retrieved a third, placing it next to the first two.
The Count gasped. He set down the first inkwell next to those on the table and stared open-mouthed at three precisely identical items. I could see from where I stood that even the dents in them were perfectly matched.
"Shakespeare's inkwell," said Holmes, "is a specialty item known among certain dealers of antiquities along the Portobello Road. They are a relatively cheap reproduction. The maker of these keeps the price high by only releasing them very, very selectively to certain types of buyers, such as yourself. Another inkwell resides with a man in San Francisco, and a third in Moscow."
"I paid a king's ransom for that!"
"Oh, darling," cried the Countess.
The Count wheeled on us, his face a bright red, not like a robin, but rather like a cardinal, I thought. "Get out of here! I never want to see either of you again," he shouted.
"Nor I," chimed in his mate.
But the Count did not demand the return of his check, and within a few minutes we were climbing into the couple's finest carriage, which had been brought round to the front of the house on the butler's command. Just before the door shut, Peterson handed in a large picnic hamper. I opened the top. Inside was a veritable feast of pâté, cheeses, cakes, chocolates, and wine.
"For the ride, gentlemen," said he with a small bow, "and thank you."
A week later, Holmes and I sat before a roaring fire at 221B, an icy rain again bucketing down onto the street below. Winter was full upon us. My friend had been out often in the intervening days, but had spoken not a word to me of where or why. We were perusing the newspapers when I read aloud a small mention of the Count and Countess Rameau having left England to winter in the south of France.
"There to wreak more havoc," I said bitterly, feeling the pair had gotten off unscathed from their callous and criminal behaviour.
I thought again of the Rameau's three young maids, without work, without references, bereft in the freezing London winter.
"That couple is largely untouchable, I am afraid, Watson. However, there is a silver lining to this case after all. Take a look."
He handed me a paper, and I laughed at the choice of periodical. Of course I'd seen him read them all, from Ally Sloper, Lucifer, Horse and Hound, to the Times. Today it was The Lady. A small advertisement in the lower left corner of one page read, "Silver Lining, a royal fashion service, for the discerning woman who would like to be treated and attired like royalty. Three former ladies' maids offer a private service to update and maintain your dress, cosmetics, and coiffure on a daily, weekly, or monthly basis. Be exquisitely groomed, beautifully au courant, and the envy of all your friends, while we remain your secret. Taste, discretion, and impeccable references. Ask for Miss C. Smith."
"Holmes! Is this what I think? Clara Smith?"
He nodded.
"I approached Miss Smith to offer her a large share of our fee. The business was her idea, and I convinced her to take on the other two maids as well. I also secured references in writing from both of the Rameaus and several of their friends."
"Well done, Holmes," said I. "You have been a busy man. A toast, then, to this new enterprise."
I moved to the sideboard and poured us both a celebratory whiskey.
"Yes, a toast, Watson," Holmes smiled as he raised his glass. "To the silver lining."
The Curse of Carmody Grange by Eric Brown.
On referring to my notes, I am reminded that the winter of 1890 was exceedingly severe, with a cold snap gripping the land and a fall of snow covering the city of London to a depth of 6 inches. On the morning of January 23rd, having been called out in the early hours to minister to the needs of an ailing major in Bloomsbury, it was almost 11 by the time I returned to find Holmes toasting his thin hands before the blazing fire.
"There's breakfast on the sideboard," said he. "I would ask Mrs. Hudson to reheat it if I were you. She was all for taking it away, as punishment for an assumed drink-fueled late night. But I prevailed upon her to show mercy and explained that you had been called out to Major Fotheringay."
"How the deuce do you know I was over at Fotheringay's, Holmes?"
"Simplicity itself. You mentioned the Major's gout last week, and when I arose I observed that your bag was not at its usual station in the hall, and that the magnesium was absent from your rack of medical supplies. The deduction was therefore obvious. You had been summoned by the Major."
I glanced at Holmes as I sat down and tucked into the bacon. "I won't bother Mrs. Hudson," I said. "Cold breakfast never harmed anyone. Got quite accustomed to lukewarm kedgeree in Afghanistan." I paused, chewing thoughtfully, and observed a certain vim in my friend's demeanour as he rubbed his hands together and turned to roast his backside before the flames. For the past fortnight, Holmes had been sunk in a slough of despond, with frequent recourse to his 7% solution. Holmes was at his very worst when his brain was inactive, which produced in him a physiological lassitude ameliorated only by his fondness for cocaine. But now his eyes sparkled, and a vitality informed his movements, brought about not by drugs, I surmised, but by some intellectual puzzle presented to tax his intellect. "I say, Holmes, are you working on a case?" He turned his aquiline visage and favoured me with a sardonic glance.
"From time to time, Watson, your powers of observation astound me."
"Out with it, man," I demanded, ignoring his heavy-handed sarcasm. He seated himself in his armchair beside the fire and crossed his long legs.
"This morning," said he, "I was called upon by a young lady and presented with a pretty problem. You have heard, I take it, of Oswald Carmody?"
"Of course. His volumes on the occult are famous, though I rather think there has been nothing new from his pen for a decade or more."
"Just so. And pray tell, what do you make of his work?"
"Well, his books are first-rate examples of their kind, if you go in for that type of thing."
"That type of thing," Holmes repeated with scorn. "Trifling accounts of the supernatural. Tales of ghosts and ghouls and things, to employ the cliché, that go bump in the night. In other words, poppycock."
"Quite," I said. "But what has all this got to do with your lady visitor?" He stared into space, a long forefinger stroking the line of his jaw before he replied.
"Amelia Carmody claimed that her father's stories are based on fact, that the many and various shades, spectres, and apparitions that appear in his lurid little accounts do in actuality exist. More to the point, she also made the claim, before she returned to Hampshire on the 10 o'clock train, that the occult had a direct bearing on her father's sudden disappearance 3 days ago."
"Oswald Carmody has disappeared?" I exclaimed.
"Vanished. Clean off the face of the earth, according to his daughter," he said. "And according to the report in yesterday's Times." He glanced up at the carriage clock on the mantelshelf. "There is a train leaving Waterloo at a little before 1 o'clock, Watson. Are you game?"
"Need you ask, Holmes?" said I.
"Then pack an overnight bag, and I will recount what Miss Carmody told me once we are..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.